Hey, good morning, Meeting House. How you doing? Good to see you guys. Welcome to Palm Sunday. My name is James Thomason. I'm the pastor here at Meeting House Church. And before we get started, I just want to make a few announcements, okay? A couple of things. Number one is our egg hunt that we have every year out on the town hall lawn right there. We postponed it from yesterday. So it's going to be next Saturday, okay? So if you can come out and help, we would certainly love it. If you want to volunteer, show up at 9. We'll spread the eggs out. We'll get the age lanes set up and all that stuff. And then the egg hunt starts at 10. And it literally, I timed it last year. I think we have about 8,000. Well, last year, I think we had 9,000 eggs. And it took like 4 minutes. So we're done at 10:04, okay? Then clean up, okay? Next Sunday is Easter, and I hope you got one of these invite cards. So invite a friend, invite a family member, bring them to hear about Jesus' resurrection and the difference that Jesus' resurrection will make in their lives and does make in our lives. And then Maggie Santangelo, as you know, whenever one of our moms and wives is pregnant here, we want to celebrate that as a church body. So we're having another baby shower. That'll be for Maggie Santangelo. You can see the time and dates up there. And finally, I want to give you a report about Dave Champagne. Okay, Dave is, as you know, he got RSV probably a month and a half ago. Got very, very sick. Didn't know if he was going to pull through. While he was in the hospital, he had 2 heart attacks, and he's recovering now, and he's doing really well, okay? So praise God for that. Thank you for the prayers and everything. Amen. Yeah, and through that, Dave has gotten into some financial need, okay? So if you have the means, then today I'm going to ask, it's about $2,400 that he's in need from this sickness. So if you have the means and ability to give, I'd ask you to take an envelope and maybe put an extra few dollars in there that we're going to help Dave with his expenses because of this medical issue that he's been through, okay? That's something that, you know, we do as a church body. For everybody. We don't want anyone, we want to become beside anyone who needs help in our church family, right? Okay? So just leave that to you. If you'll do it, write it on one of the envelopes in the seat back pocket in front of you. You can just put Dave or Dave C on it if that's for him, okay? All right. Let me get us started with prayer and then we'll worship. Let me just say one more thing just to prep. Right, today's baptism. I think we have 7 people. One of our baptism candidates is out of town, right? So I think we have 7 people following the Lord in baptism today. That's going to be at the end of the service. So if you are being baptized today, after I finish speaking, I will dismiss us. We'll go downstairs. We'll change. You know, we'll do that walk, and we'll magically appear back here. And we'll do that. So please hang around for that. That'll be right as the last part of our service, okay? Let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for this day. Today, we focus our minds and our hearts on the death of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. And God, you glorified yourself and him through his death. And I pray that you would, through the power of your word, as we teach it, as we sing it, as we hear it, that you would glorify yourself. Show yourself to be great and wonderful in our minds and our hearts, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, church, we're going to stand and sing a few songs to the Lord this morning. So stand with me and we'll get started.
Promise is true. My are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through always, always. My soul will rest in You. I will not fear the war. I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way. My help is on the way. Oh, my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. From the Lord.
One more time, church.
I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord, from You, Lord. Oh my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true. My God will come through always, always, always. Stood before creation, eternity in Your hand. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failure, carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon Your shoulders, my soul now to stand.
So what can I say?
So what can I say? And what can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll walk upon salvation, your Spirit alive in me, my life to declare your promise, my soul now to stand. So what can I say? What can I do but offer this heart, oh God, completely to you? So what can I say? And what can I do? Offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned. Let's sing it out to him.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe. One who gave it all, I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered. All I am is yours. I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand. Surrendered all I am is yours. So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all I am.
One more time.
So I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe, one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. All I am is yours. All I am is yours. So what can I say? And what can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So what can I say? And what can I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you.
We're going to take a moment and pray. Pray by yourself or with a partner, but let's just reflect on what God has done for us, and just give some back to Him. Church, it was good worshiping with you. Find someone you didn't come with and just shake their hands and say you're happy to see them here today. And the children are dismissed.
All right, everybody. Let's see. One note. Parents, when we dismiss the baptism candidates, if you want your, you can go ahead and go downstairs and check your child out of kids, MHC kids, and bring them back up if you'd like them to watch the baptism. I know my wife, Christy, she heads up our children's ministry, and she instructed me to do that, to say that. So go get your kids, bring them back up, and we'll all enjoy the baptism together. So last week, we're in a series. We started a series called The Life, Death, Resurrection, and Return of Jesus Christ. So last week, we looked at the life of Jesus. What was the purpose of Jesus' life? And to sum up last week in a sentence, I bet you wish I would have just done that last week. We looked at the life of Jesus Christ and learned this. Jesus lived to show us who God is, right? Jesus said, when you see me, you see the Father. When you hear me, you hear the Father, right? I and the Father are one, he said. And then he lived also to show us that he is the way to the Father, right? Jesus is the way that God has provided for you and me and everyone who will believe to get back into relationship with God. Today, we're going to look at Jesus' death, all right? And let me set the scene. If you have your Bible or you've got your phone or whatever, you want to flip to John chapter 12. That's where we're going to be today. And in the Bible here, in John chapter 12, it is the same day that it is today. It's Sunday. It is what we now call Palm Sunday, right? And so Jesus is going to be, the Passover is on Thursday night. Going to be this Thursday. Jesus is arrested and crucified, right, on Friday. He's dead and in the grave Friday evening, Saturday, and he rises back to life on Sunday. Now, Jerusalem is absolutely packed with people on this day because they are there to celebrate the Passover. The city population has exploded. There are crowds in the street, and Jesus, after preaching and teaching and healing throughout Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and Israel, is now coming into Jerusalem on a donkey, right? And the crowds are putting palm branches on the road in front of him. And this is actually a fulfillment of prophecy. This was foretold that would happen. Zechariah foretold it hundreds and hundreds of years prior. And so that's why we call it Palm Sunday. So Jesus is riding in. And as he's riding in, they're shouting to him, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," right? Blessed is the King of Israel. So they recognize that Jesus is the long-awaited Messiah, kind of, not completely, because in a few days they're going to be shouting, "Crucify him," this same crowd, right? They do not yet understand that as the Messiah, he must die and rise again to conquer their sin and ours. And so let's pick up right there in John chapter 12, starting in verse 20. Now, there were some Greeks, some non-Hebrew people, believers probably called God-fearers at that time. There were some Greeks among those who went up to worship at the festival. That's the Passover festival. They came to Philip, one of Jesus' apostles, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, with a request. "Sir," they said, help me out with this. What did they ask? "We would like to see Jesus." Okay? Now, before I go on, right, if you've read much of the Gospels, and particularly the Gospel of John, you kind of got to learn how to read Jesus. Right? Because he almost never answers a request or a question directly. He always makes us think. Okay? And so what comes after this is Jesus answering their request. He's going to show them who he is. Okay? And he's going to do it in two things. He's going to do it by explaining that he has to die and that his death brings glory to him and God the Father, okay? "Sir, we would like to see Jesus." Philip went to tell Andrew, another apostle, and Andrew and Philip then in turn told Jesus. Let's pick up in the next verse, verse 23, next slide. Jesus replied, "The hour has come for," help me out there, with what? "For the Son of Man to be glorified." The time, the hour, the time has come, Jesus says, for the Son of Man to be glorified. Now, maybe you're not too deep into the Bible. Son of Man is a reference back to Daniel. It was kind of Jesus' favorite title for himself. He would call himself the Son of Man. It referred to how Daniel referred to the Messiah. So it's time for the Son of Man to be glorified. The hour has come for me to be glorified. Jesus said, very plainly here, that his death glorified him. And we'll see later, he says, his death glorified God the Father as well. Okay? So we have one big point that we're going to hit from three different directions today. Okay? And here it is. The death of Jesus Christ displays God the Father's and His glory. Okay? It shows us the glory of God and the glory of Jesus Christ. All right? Now, that may not mean a lot to us at this point, but hopefully I'll be able to explain why it should. God's glory is a very, very important reality in the Bible. It's a very important reality to God Himself. It's important to believers in the Bible, Old Testament and New Testament, right? So I think then God's glory should be important to us, right? We ought to know what God's glory is and what it means for God to be glorious. Do you agree? By my count, I sat down and counted how many times God is called glorious, or the Bible speaks of the glory of God, or the glory of the Lord, or the glory of His name, or the glory of His kingdom. Probably about 107 different times in the Bible. The Bible speaks of God's glory. My concern is this, and it's one of the reasons why I think I chose this topic, and maybe God led me there, if I can be so bold to say, is that in normal American Christianity, we hardly speak of God's glory anymore. When is the last time you heard some preacher, some teacher speak about how great and glorious God is? Few of us understand how important it is for us to know God's glory. So here's the question. Can you say that our faith in Jesus Christ is fully biblical if we don't understand and know and value the glory of God? If it's that valuable to God, if it's that valuable to believers in the Bible, it ought to be valuable to us, right? It ought to be part. It shouldn't be something, some foreign concept. So what is the glory of God? Well, it's not easy to define. Basically, the glory of God is kind of like the sum total of everything that God is. It is all of His power. It's all of His love. It's all of His faithfulness. It's all of His holiness. It's all of His mercy. It's all of His justice, His kindness, His patience, His intelligence, everything. It's all just kind of balled up into one, and really represents, God's glory represents just His utter, I strive for words, like I've been praying for words for 3 days. It is just God's magnificence all considered and put on display at once. That's what it is. It is the fact that God is unmatched, singular, unique in every way and altogether. Just unbelievably awesome and powerful. Perfection in every way. Sometimes God in the Bible, and I believe He still does this now, sometimes God reveals His glory to us physically. So I want you to think about this for a second. God is such a great and powerful, and Jesus as well, glorious being, okay, that when, let me put it this way, His glory creates a physical atmosphere that God, just out of His awesomeness, just creates an atmosphere around Himself. And that atmosphere in the Bible is described most often as like unbearable light. It is so bright that you can't look at it. Sometimes it's described as a cloud, like a backlit cloud, that you can't look at. I remember when I was thinking about this, I remember I was playing baseball in college, playing outfield one day, and most of the time, I've got blue eyes, so my eyes are very light sensitive, and I would like overcast days because I could see. But there was this one game where the sun above the clouds, it was totally overcast, But the sun was so strong above the clouds that it just kind of made the entire sky too bright to look at. Like I couldn't look up without my eyes watering. That's a little idea of the glory of God, okay? Sometimes God's glory is sound as well. It creates an atmosphere of light and sound. And when we understand or see or comprehend some of God's glory, His glory is always overwhelming. You know if you've understood the glory of God, if you've ever been overwhelmed with God's presence. Israel, right? God revealed His glory to the entire nation of Israel on top of Mount Sinai, right? And it was a scary revelation. As a matter of fact, the entire nation decided God had invited all of them up to the peak of Mount Sinai to give all of them the law, but they were so in fear of God's glory that only Moses and Joshua would go up. Everybody else stayed away. Isaiah saw God's glory in a vision in Isaiah chapter 6, right? And I don't mean to scare us here, but do you remember Isaiah's response when he saw God's glory? Right? He saw this vision of God in his temple, and it says, the smoke of God's glory, of his presence, filled the temple. And Isaiah's response was, woe is me. I am going to be destroyed. That's what he thought when he came in contact with God's glory. He thought, it's over for me. This is too intense. This is not survivable. Ezekiel, if you've ever read Ezekiel, right? It's God gives Ezekiel a revelation, a picture, a vision of God's glorious chariot, right? He describes this crazy chariot, and Ezekiel gets the same. The Mount of Transfiguration, Peter, James, and John went up there with Jesus, right? And Jesus was transfigured in their presence, and they laid down as though they were dead. It's kind of like the same reaction all the time. Revelation chapter 1, John gets a vision, a revelation of Jesus' glory, and it says he fell down on his hands and knees as though dead. And then Jesus had to put his hand on him and say, hey, it's all right. It's all right. Jesus said his death displays his glory, his utter greatness, his power, right? Now, we're used to thinking about the gospel, right? The life, death, and Jesus Christ as being about us. It's for us, right? Jesus did it that for us. God did that for us. But what I want to impress us with today is that the death of Jesus, the gospel, is the good news about Jesus, right? It's not the good news about us. It is the good news about Jesus Christ and God, okay? It is all about His glory, all about the Father's glory, all about them and what they did and who they are. Let's look at this in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4. It says this, "The God of this age," that's Satan, if you're wondering, "has blinded the minds of unbelievers." Jesus actually said one time, the whole world lies under the power of the evil one, right? "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers." Before I was a sophomore in college and I repented and put my faith in Jesus Christ, the God of this age had blinded my eyes to Jesus Christ, right? But something gives us sight and enables us to see who this Jesus is. And Paul tells us right here what that is. "The God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot," what? "See." We can't see something. What is it? It is the light of the gospel, which is what? The glory of Christ, who is the image of God. The gospel, the life, death, and resurrection is all, it shines. It is a beacon, a light of the greatness and the glory and the goodness of God. That's what it is. It's all about who he is. It's all about God's worth, not my worth. It's all about his perfection, not mine. It's all about his power, his faithfulness, his love, his mercy, his holiness, right? The gospel is about the glory of God. So let's go back to John chapter 12, verse 23, and pick up, because here's how Jesus, the first way that Jesus says his death glorifies him or brings him glory, all right? So Jesus replied, I'll start back again, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified." Now we know what that is. For the Son of Man's greatness, his power, everything about him to be put on display. Okay, that's what Jesus' death did. It displayed his greatness. "Very truly, I tell you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life will lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life." So Jesus says, if a seed dies, it produces many seeds. If it doesn't, it just remains by itself, right? So Jesus here is comparing himself to a seed of wheat that is buried in the ground, dies, then produces a stalk of wheat that has hundreds of seeds on it that will in turn produce plants with seeds that have hundreds of other seeds on it. You get the picture? Jesus is comparing his death to this one seed of wheat that if he dies, he is going to produce eternal life for as many people as will put their faith in him. For literally millions and billions of people. Okay? Jesus says, hey, if I don't do this, then I remain alive, but nobody else does. But if I die, I am going to create eternal life for millions and millions of people. I am going to create forgiveness for millions and millions of people, for as many, a number only limited by as many as will turn and put their faith in him, right? Jesus' death glorifies him because it created eternal life. Jesus' death reveals his power. You see that? Imagine a life so powerful, a person so incredibly powerful that by dying he can create eternal life for millions, for billions of people. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 16 says this, "Jesus became our high priest." How? "On the basis of the power of an indestructible life." Listen, folks, we have to keep our concept, our idea, our faith of God elevated to where he is. And it's a very difficult thing, right? It's very easy for me to shrink Jesus down and make him smaller than my stresses, than my problems, than my sins, right? Than my issues that are going on in my life, okay? Than my own life or my own death. Listen, Jesus has the power of an indestructible life. Jesus is indestructible. He is God, okay? And this is where we always, right, we've got too much thinking about Jesus is my comforter. I'm not saying he is, okay? He's our comforter, right? He's the guy who loves me. He is. Jesus is my friend. Yes, he is. But he is also the eternal, indestructible, forever powerful God who holds the keys of life and death, okay? He does. He's master over your life and my life. He's master over your death and my death. He is master over your eternal life. Listen, when you have a picture, an understanding of faith in Jesus that is this, which is reality, right? Does death scare you at all? Are you going to ever wonder, I wonder if my eternal life is real? Jesus does not want you wondering that. If Jesus is indestructible, then your eternal life is indestructible. You have nothing to fear in this world. The day that you die will be the greatest day that you have ever lived in your life. That's the truth. You will never have a greater day on this earth as a believer in Jesus Christ than the day that you wake up with Him. It will be the greatest day ever. Like, that's what I'm living for, man. Right? That's something that keeps me going, that I can get excited about in life. Right? So Jesus' death created eternal life. Jesus' death glorifies Him because it reveals His power. Listen to what He said in John chapter 10, verses 17 and 18. He said this. Let me read it. I was going to quote it from memory, but just let me read it. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. Man, that's power. That's power. That you can lay your life down and then take it right back up again at your own choosing. This is the power that your Savior has. This is the power of Jesus in your life. Now I've gotten myself confused here. There we go. Let's go back to Jesus' answer. So Jesus' death glorifies Him and the Father. It glorifies Him by revealing His power first. The power of an indestructible life. It created eternal life for us. Verse 27. Now my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? No. No. It was for this very reason I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Father, glorify your name. It's for this very reason. Right, Father? Should I live a life of complete love and obedience to you, of complete love for my fellow man? Should I come here and then back away from this very reason that you gave, that I was born into this world? And what was it? To die. Right? No, it's for this very reason that I came to this hour. And then He says, Father, glorify your name. So Jesus' death glorifies the Father as well. How does it glorify? It glorifies Jesus and God the Father because, listen to this, Jesus' death is and was their plan from eternity. It was always God's plan for His Son, and it was always Jesus' plan for Him to be born into this world to die for people like you and me. He was literally born to hang on the cross. He was born to be arrested, to be beaten, to have a crown of thorns crammed down upon His head, to have spikes driven through His wrists and His ankles, to have a spear shoved in His side, and to die in that way for you and for me, for a purpose that we'll get to in a minute. It was their plan. Peter said it this way in Acts chapter 2. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. Listen, I want you to understand, because when we get around Easter and Christmas, you know, all the Jesus specials come out on TV, right? Back in the day when we still had those things called magazines, you know, all the magazines would have the Jesus specials, right? It's time for a Jesus issue, right? And I hate this. Christy and I talk about, we wonder about our own spirituality because people come to us and say, oh, did you see that new movie about Jesus? It's awesome. And we're always like, I didn't really like it. Is there something wrong with me? Honestly, the only Jesus movie I like was The Passion of Christ by Mel Gibson. It's the only one. That's not a comment on anything. If you love other ones, that's fine. I'm not. But here's what gets me about Jesus movies. Is it makes, first of all, it makes Jesus, they all make Jesus look like some wimpy hippie dude who smokes weed on the side. You know what I mean? Like, I can't have it. They do, right? I can't handle it. Right? They all make Jesus look like this kind of wimpy, weak, like Jesus was the most powerful man that ever walked the earth. I mean, who could carry a cross out to Golgotha like that? One of the reasons why I love The Passion of the Christ is because of that scene. Like, the scene in that movie is when Jesus is carrying his cross, it's like everyone and everything is trying to get him to stop. Like Satan is trying, the Romans, they're all trying to make him unable to reach Golgotha, and Jesus just won't have it. No matter how tired, how beaten, how much opposition, he's going to bend over, he's going to pick that cross up, and he's going to carry it to the hill where he knows that he is destined to die. And nothing is going to get in his way. Listen, Jesus' death was not an accident. It was a plan. It was not a tragedy. It was a victory. It was not a triumph. I mean, not a defeat. It was a triumph. Do you understand that? Jesus did not die because he was weak and overpowered. He died because he is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, and no one can match him. Do you understand that? That's why Jesus died. He is great and awesome and beyond imagination. He died because it was their plan. And the plan is so amazing. It brings so much glory to him and the Father because he died to suffer the judgment that you and I deserve. Right? Here's where we get down to it. This is it right here. Let's go back to our verse here. Next slide, John chapter 28. Father, glorify your name, Jesus said. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. The crowd that was there and heard it said it had thundered. Others said an angel had spoken to him. Jesus said, this voice was for your benefit, not for mine. See, he didn't need it, right? He knew why he was there. Verse 31. Now is the time for what? For judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be cast out, right? I want you to think about that. Jesus said his death is the time for judgment on this world. Okay, we don't think of the cross this way very often. Okay, but it is as much as the cross is about the love of God, it is also about the justice and judgment of God. We have to understand that. Okay? Jesus said, now, in my death is the time for judgment on this world. Jesus' death glorifies him and the Father because his death is and was God's judgment on the world. L- Let me put it to you this way. When you think about, right, I mean, we need to take time and meditate. I'll get to that in the last point. But one of the reasons why we are not overwhelmed with the glory of God is we don't meditate on the greatness of God. We don't meditate on what Jesus did for us, okay? But what I want you to see is that on the cross, everything that we see and read about that was done to Jesus, okay? He's arrested, he's beaten, he's mocked, he's spit on. I already went through it, right? He's whipped, right? To the point of death. Whipped, I'm not trying to be gruesome here, but we need to understand what he went through. Like, he's whipped with what's called a cat of nine tails. It's a handle with leather thong, and on the end of that is pieces of rock or glass. And he's whipped with that. And so that rips the skin and flesh off your back, right? Most people died from this, okay, at that time. This is all the crown of thorns, right? All that to the cross, nailed, everything. Okay? What is that? And we think about, oh, look what the Roman soldiers did to him. Oh, look what the chief priest did to him. No, like what we need to understand is that was God the Father doing that to his Son so that we would not have to suffer what he was suffering. Because that is what you and I deserve for our sin against God. That's the gospel. See, Jesus' death was displaced justice. It was displaced justice. What I mean is this. That's the justice that I deserve, that the world deserves for our rebellion, our sin, our rejection of God who created us to love us. Okay, that's a picture, right? And that's what we deserve. But God, in his great love and in his great mercy, said, no, I will not do that to those who deserve it, but instead, I will do that, and Jesus is all in on this, okay? Jesus is not rebelling. He said, it's for this very hour I came, right? I will displace the justice that the world deserves onto my Son. So that whoever in this world who has rebelled against me, who has rejected me, who I created for my love, for myself, to live with me now and forever. So whoever in this world that deserved that, whoever will put their faith in my Son, guess what? They get me and my love and my forgiveness and my presence in their life and eternal life. This is what the cross is, folks. This is what Jesus, this is the glory of God, what he did. It's incredible. It's just incredible to think that God would have that. And basically God held himself to his own standard of judgment. It's what he did for our sake. It's just literally unbelievable. Let's go back. Now we get to kind of why it's all, this is the end for you and me. John chapter 12, verse 32, Jesus continues and said, when I am lifted up from the earth, that's his death on the cross, I will draw all people to myself. Jesus' death glorifies him because through it, he draws us to himself, to forgiveness, to salvation, to God himself, to eternal life, to a life now in this world with this great and glorious God in, or better, I get to now live, you get to now live your life in this world with this great and glorious God. I will draw all people to myself. He said this to show the kind of death that he was going to die. I'll stop right there. We are drawn to Jesus when he shows us his glory. Earlier I said, and we saw that God's glory is overwhelming, right? When we get just a glimpse of God's glory, right? Whether it's comprehension under or God graciously gives us some kind of vision, which I think still happens, just not very often, right? When we get a glimpse of God's glory, it is overwhelming. Okay, it overcomes us. It changes us forever, right? It may bring us dread in the moment. It may bring us fear. It will lead us to worship, right? Almost every time when somebody in Scripture is overcome, is confronted, really is a good word, with the glory of God, they fall down in worship, right? That's what they do. They end up on their hands and knees in worship before God. God's glory, the one thing God's glory won't leave you is indifferent. It will not leave you lukewarm. It will not leave you mediocre. It will overwhelm you. Possibly the single greatest reason why our faith, and I include mine, is so weak in America these days, or at least not as strong as it could be, is because we do not understand. We have not been overwhelmed by the glory of God. I'm too busy asking God to fix my problems. I'm too busy complaining to God about, oh no, what about this? Or oh no, what about that? I'm not saying those problems are not important to God. Okay, but what I am saying is that they all shrink to insignificance in light of the glory of God. Okay? And the glory of God will take care of those. The glory of God will take care of those. You say, man, I want to believe. I want to have more faith. I've got all kinds of stress in my life. There's all kinds of difficult things going. There are. I'm not diminishing this, right? We deal with real difficulty in this life. But we get focused on those things and our eyes are taken off the greatness and glory of God. And we begin to doubt and we begin to fear and we begin to go in wrong directions. But if we kept our eyes on the greatness and glory of God, none of it would faze us in the way that it does. And God, he'll be faithful. It's part of God's glory to be faithful. It's part of God's glory to do what he's promised to do in our lives. When I find myself getting distracted and down, I'm speaking personally here just as so you understand what I'm saying. When I find myself getting sinful, you know what I figure out? I've already, before that happened, I already lost my vision of the glory of God. God already became small before I went away. We need to be overwhelmed by the glory of God. Have you ever been overwhelmed by the glory of God? You know, we can't get God to give us a vision, okay? But we can seek God in his word and in prayer. You know, when I was in seminary, you know, seminary school, graduate school, just really, and I try to keep this up, but learning about the glory of God and how people like lived in this with this concept, and I'd read about men and women who pursued the glory of God, and they would speak about being overcome with his glory, and I'd be like, man, I want that, you know. Then you read a little farther, and you find out what you got to do to get there. Okay, the glory of God. If you want a vision, a recognition and understanding of the glory of God, listen, you're going to have to dig. You're going to have to seek the Lord. You're going to have to meditate on him. And it's going to take effort. But God will reward you. Listen, I'm not bragging. This is available to everybody. Okay, it's available to every believer. But I can tell you, man, there's been times in my life when I sat by myself, just overwhelmed with the glory of God because I meditated on him in prayer for hours and just crazy stuff. You know, if you pass by, if I was standing on the side of the road, you might think I'm crazy. You know, if you just drove past me, because I'm laughing, I'm crying, I'm praising, I'm on my knees. God is revealing himself, and he will reveal his glory to you. and it will change you. It will change you. God's glory will never leave you bored with him. God's glory will never leave you take it or leave it. God's glory will always touch you and change you and make you stronger. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you, Lord, that you are so glorious. Your power is evident in your death, Lord Jesus. For you created eternal life for us, Lord. God, your power, your glory is evident in your plan that you would suffer everything that I, that we, that the entire world deserves as your judgment. But in mercy, Lord, you displaced that. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for receiving that willfully, for suffering it, for conquering it, and rising from the grave. God, I pray you would give us a glory, a vision, an understanding, a comprehension of your greatness and your glory. We need it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, listen, if you're getting baptized today, now's the time. We're going to head back. We'll go downstairs and change and be ready, okay? It's a good time now to go down, check your kids out, and bring them back up for baptism.
Okay, church, while they get ready, we're going to do one more song. So stand up and let's praise God one more time today.
But he brought me in, oh, his love for me, oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes, I am. Realized he has
Okay. Someone's holding us up. So we're going to do one more song. We're going to do Always again.
My God will come.